Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics, and today we will see the classification of an electrical network. So the electrical network broadly can be classified in five different categories, and this classification depends on the two things. The first is the properties of the circuit elements which are connected in the electrical network, and the second is the response of the network for the different excitations. So the first three types of the network are based on the properties of the circuit elements, and the remaining two kind of networks are based on the response of the network for the different excitations. So let's see them one by one. So the first is the active and the passive network. So let us first of all understand the active and the passive elements. So the active elements are the elements which are capable of delivering energy to the external devices. And the example of the active elements are the voltage and the current source. So now let's see the passive elements. The passive elements are capable of receiving energy or the power. And the example of the passive elements are the resistor, capacitor and the inductor. So the resistor dissipates the received energy in the form of heat, while the capacitor and the inductor stores the finite amount of energy, and later on they are able to deliver this energy for the finite amount of time. So the capacitor and inductor can deliver the energy for the only finite amount of time, unlike the active elements which are capable of delivering the energy for the infinite time. So here we will add one more term in the definition of active elements, that is, they are capable of delivering the energy for the infinite time. So if the network which contains the active elements like voltage source and the current source can be called as an active network. Likewise, the network which contains the elements like resistor, capacitor and the inductor can be called as a passive network. So now let's see the second kind of network, that is unilateral and the bilateral network. So let us first understand the unilateral and the bilateral elements. So in the bilateral elements, the current can flow in the both the directions. So the example of these bilateral elements are the resistor, capacitor and the inductor. So in these elements, the current can flow in any direction. There is no restriction on the flow of current in the any of the direction. While in case of a unilateral elements, the current can flow only in the one direction. The example of such elements is the diode. So diode allows the flow of current only in the one direction, and it restricts the flow in the another direction. The another example of a unilateral element is the transistor, which allows the flow of current only in the one direction. So if the network contains such unilateral elements, then it is called a unilateral network. And the example of such network is the rectifier circuit. If the network contains the elements like resistor, capacitor and the inductor, then it is called a bilateral network. So now let us see the third kind of network, that is lumped and the distributed network. So in a lumped network, the circuit elements like resistor, capacitor and inductor can be separated physically. So in the lumped network, we can easily remove such elements from the network. We can measure them, we can replace them. So if the network contains such discrete elements, then such networks can be called as a lumped network. So now let's see the distributed network. So unlike the lumped network, in the distributed network, we cannot separate the circuit elements like resistor, capacitor and the inductor, as they all are act as a single entity, and they are distributed along the length of the network. So the example of a distributed network is the transmission line or a coaxial cable. So if you see the specification of any coaxial cable, they used to define a resistance, capacitance and inductance per unit length, as they are distributed along the length of the network. The fourth kind of network are the linear and the nonlinear network. So in case of a linear network, the relation between the input and output is a linear. Likewise, in the nonlinear network, the relation between the input and output is a nonlinear. Also, the linear network follows the principle of superposition. That means they have two properties, homogeneity and the additivity. So let us first see the property of homogeneity. So let us first assume that here we have an electrical network. And in this network, we are applying a 10 volt as a input. And in the response, we are getting a 2 volt as a output, which is the 1/5 of the input voltage. So now let's just scale it up the input voltage by the factor of 2. So now the input voltage is a 20 volt. Now if the network follows the property of homogeneity, then whenever we apply 20 volt as an input, then at the output we should get a 4 volt. That means the response should also get scaled by the same factor. So in general way we can say that if E1 is the excitation and R1 is the response, then whenever we scale it up excitation by the factor of alpha, then the response should also get scaled by the same factor. So that is the property of homogeneity. Now let us see the property of additivity. Now let us just assume that we have one network. In this network, whenever we are applying a 10 volt as an input, we are getting a 4 volt as an output. And in this network, when we are applying a 20 volt as an input, we are getting a 8 volt as an output. So now let's just add these two input voltages and apply it as an excitation to this network. So if the network follows the property of additivity, then the output response should be the summation of the individual responses. That means whenever we apply a 30 volt as an input, then at the output we should get a response of 12 volt. Or in general way we can say that whenever we are applying a E1 plus E2 as an input, then at the response we should get a R1 plus R2, where R1 and R2 are the individual responses for the excitation E1 and E2 respectively. So that is the property of additivity. So now let's just combine the properties of additivity and the homogeneity. So if we apply excitation alpha E1 plus beta E2 to the network, then if we are getting a response alpha R1 plus beta R2, then we can say that the network is a linear. Or in another way, if the network follows the principle of superposition, then we can say that the network is a linear. Or if it does not follow this superposition theorem, then we can say that the network is a nonlinear. So now let us see the fifth kind of network, that is time invariant and the time variant. So let us assume that we have one network, and in this network we are applying a excitation E1, and at the response we are getting a response R1. Now the network can be called a time invariant if the response R1 is independent of the time at which this excitation is applied. That means if we apply this excitation at time t or time t plus capital T, in the both the cases if we are getting the same response R1, or in another way, if this response R1 is independent of the time at which this excitation is applied, then we can say that the network is a time invariant. So in case of a time variant network, the response R1 depends upon the time at which the excitation is applied. So we will get a response R1 when we are applying excitation at time t. Now if we apply the same excitation at time t plus t, then we will get a different response, let's say R2. So in such case, we can say that the network is a time variant network. So I hope you understood the different types of electrical networks. If you have any questions or suggestions, please let me know in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.